Good evening, everyone. Man, does that sound nice. Before we begin tonight, last Friday, some of the staff came in just to check the place out before this event to see how things had changed and if there were lights and sound. And I sent out an email, we'll put them in the dark. to see what the community house had done. And I just have to say, there needs to be an uproarious round of applause for the team accomplished. I don't know if there are any board members or staff here, but really, congratulations on what you've done here. I'm sure whoever does the schedule for the community house is going to be very, very busy. Another thing I observed when I came in this morning was that the water doesn't look too bad. And I was very encouraged. I figured that row and maybe that row would have people in it tonight. Because every time before when the water has gone clear and nice, everyone kind of forgets about the issue. You haven't forgotten. Thank you. And I really think we've turned a corner, and that feels really good. The program tonight is a joint one between the Everglades Foundation and SCCF. The Everglades Foundation is a significant, respected, important advocate for the greater Everglades ecosystem. They have a grant program that we receive grants from for our advocacy work. And I would like to introduce and recognize Eric Eichenberg, who is the Chief Executive Officer of the Everglades Foundation, who you'll hear from later. Thanks, Eric. I need some lights. I know how it is for lights and sound, guys, when you're shaking your system down.
It's day two.
It's day two. Got the stage lights back?
Yep.
So, all right. Thank you. I'd also like to recognize our partners, the Ding Darling National Wildlife Refuge and Paul Tritech, the refuge manager. Thank you, Paul, for all your help and assistance and spirit here on the island. And also to the city of Sanibel. And I'm looking at the back row here, and every councilman from the city of Sanibel is here tonight. Mayor Ruane, who is championing the effort for water quality in this region by bringing local municipalities together, traveling to Tallahassee, traveling to Washington, and yelling to the mountains that we need clean water. We're very appreciative, Mr. Mayor. And to Councilman Denham and Harity, and Goss and Jennings, thank you for coming tonight. And Mick, I have to say, you know, long, long time ago with the Regional Planning Council and other groups, you started this effort a long time ago, and the council and now the mayor have really taken it and run with it. I appreciate all your work.
Yep.
Also tonight, very encouraging, we have staff from Congressman Francis Rooney's office, Matt Pusateri, and Augustina Pardall are here. Thank you. Thank you. I'm just so encouraged by the crowd. Thanks to the support of this community, SCCF is celebrating its first 50 years of conservation work on the islands. When I saw a trailer for Tom Brokaw, who just did something about his 50 years, it struck me that it was titled The First 50 Years. And that just, we're carrying on. Some of the work that we do and have done over the years has had a direct and immediate impact on our mission. The land acquisition that we do protects wildlife habitat and open space. The land management we do assures that The best habitat possible will be on the island. Our native plant landscaping and garden center is providing landscapes for wildlife in the developed parts of the island. Our sea turtle and shorebird program are ensuring the viability of the beaches for nesting. The marine laboratory is doing seagrass, mangrove, and oyster restoration to help repair some of the marine habitat scars that we've incurred in the past as a result of water management activities. So those are immediate and direct impacts we've had. But some of our work in the realm of education and advocacy is much more daunting, especially when it comes to regulation, legislation, and appropriation for conservation issues, and in this case, especially water quality issues. So tonight we'll be discussing that category, that daunting effort that we all are here to help with and engage in. The effort to establish water management infrastructure and management practices to protect the natural resources of Lake Okeechobee, the St. Lucie River, the Caloosahatchee. Stop there. Sometimes you'll see Caloosahatchee River written in publications. Caloosahatchee. Caloosahatchee is river. Caloosahatchee. So that's why a lot of times you don't see river after it. It was the Indian term hatchee for river. So you'll just see Caloosahatchee. Rayanne will correct me every time if I add river to that. The Everglades and Florida Bay. We have a real challenge ahead of us. So you've seen many things in the paper, especially in the last couple of months. And the Water Management District has published papers and emails that said myth versus facts. And I wish I was Jimmy Fallon right now to discuss myths and facts. I won't go there. But our panelists tonight are here to help you sort that out. And you really couldn't have a better panel in this region. Rayanne Wessel is here. She's SCCF's Natural Resource and Policy Director. I have to talk her down off the ledge from time to time. Tom Van Lent is the Everglades Foundation Vice President for Programs and their senior hydrologist. He's been in the system for a long time. He knows what he's talking about. So when you see him attacked, you're going to hear from him tonight and you'll know who to believe. Tom. And James Evans is the City of Sanibel's Natural Resource Policy Director. He's passionate about the job that he does. I don't know how he does it. He's the mayor's right-hand man and also takes care of the rest of our natural resources on the island. But he's incredibly dedicated to water issues and that effort. So I'm going So we appreciate you coming tonight to become engaged. We will give you ways to become engaged at the end of the evening. And what we do here tonight, what you do after we break up here, has a lot to do with our quality of life and our economy in South Florida. This is very important. And again, I'm so encouraged by all your attendance. Please spread the word after we're through tonight. Thank you. Touche. My name's Eric Lindblad. I'm the Executive Director of the Sanibel Captiva Conservation Foundation. Thank you, sir. And now I'm going to turn the mic over to Rayanne.
Thank you. So that was almost planned because tonight we have dedicated to make sure that this is a very interactive program so that you have questions, we have some explanations, and we'd like to make sure that we empower you with a lot of detail so that as you read the news paper articles that we're reading and we're in meetings hearing about, you can sort through what you're hearing and you can get a real sense about where something might be half the story, and we'll finish that sentence, we'll finish that thought and make sure that you have those pieces tonight. So with that, I thought that we would walk through some myths and facts, and there's a sheet in the back that prompts about 10 myths and facts that I have commonly heard and James and Tom have commonly heard. But I think what we're going to do is start with just three of them, and after each one, we'll engage and ask you to ask questions. And if you aren't ready yet, we'll go to the next one. But I want to make sure that while we're on topic, you have an opportunity to be very clearly understanding what we're trying to say and what the issue is. Is that fair enough?
Yeah.
Okay.
Great.
So I think with that, I'm going to just start with three. And they are listed on this handout if you picked one up in the back. How many times have you heard, or have you heard, that if we store and treat water north of Lake Okeechobee, we don't need to buy any land in the EA south of Lake Okeechobee?
Too many
times. How many times, or have you heard, that restoration of the Herbert Hoover Dyke around Lake Okeechobee is the key to storing more water in the lake and therefore eliminating the need for storage south of the lake? Okay. Then I think the third one that you might want to jump in on is it's tough to have to sort this down, but I do want to make sure we have a lot of time together. That coastal residents, us, and Everglades advocates want to eliminate agriculture, take agricultural land, take jobs, and ruin the community south of Lake Okeechobee. Have you heard that?
Yeah.
All right. So let's select those three, and we'll start with the first one. I'm going to ask Tom and then James to respond to this first one after I read it again. We'll have some images for context, and then we'll ask for your questions, and we'll have a microphone going around. So if you raise your hand, we'll make sure that everybody gets a chance to be heard. So, starting with storing and treating water north of the lake so that we don't need to buy any more land south in the EAA. Tom, what do you think? Fact or fiction?
Well, first, I want to address one thing. I'm deeply impressed by the turnout tonight. Thank you all for coming. But the one myth out there is you all and me all represent some kind of special interest, and that our motivation is purely self-interested, and therefore we don't really care about the future of Florida. But I think the turnout here tonight gives me real hope that no, this is about people who care about quality of life, care about the future. We are represent the people and the quality of life of Florida. So thank you so much for turning out. I'm amazed, so thank you. To get at the question of storage needed south of the lake, let's put it all north of the lake. I always go back to, as an engineer and hydrologist, well, how did it work before and how does it work now? Because the difference between how it worked before and how it works now is the key to understanding what's the best path. If you look at these kind of graphs, what you'll see is that on your left, the watershed into Lake Okeechobee was the Kissimmee River, and this is a satellite image from today, and it behaves pretty similarly to how it used to before we started ditching and draining. We were putting some things back in the middle of the river. We've made some serious mistakes, but we're working on fixing it. And so the amount of water that comes from that watershed into Lake Okeechobee is about the same as it used to be 100 years ago.
comes at a different time, but it's about the same. But south of Lake Okeechobee, that's a different story. All of the water that was in Lake Okeechobee would spill out and go south to the Everglades. That would average, I mean, we use this quantity called acre feet, which I know is not quite common, but it's, if I take 1 acre of land 1 foot deep, that's an acre. And so that translates to roughly 3 million gallons. We used to get an average about 1.5 million acre feet on every year leave the lake and go into the Everglades. Today, that's far less than, it's about 20,000, about 5% of the water that used to go south today. Where does the rest of it go? Well, when there's too much, I think you know where it goes. It goes mostly out the Coosahatchee and some out the St. Lucie. So the question is, why is that? And it's because the Central and South Florida Project was designed to work that way. It's not an artifact of some rule, but that's when the engineers planned it. That's how they planned it to work.
It works well.
It certainly does from their perspective. The water's gone. So it's why I think I can state without fear of contradiction, it's going to continue to happen again and again and again, because that's how it was designed to work. The fix is the Comprehensive Everglades Restoration Plan. That is what replumbs one of the largest water management systems in the world. And the biggest change we have to make is, instead of throwing the water away to the St. Lucie and the Coosahatchee, start sending it south again. That is the fundamental structural problem this water management system faces, and is a cause of the problems you see here in the Coosahatchee, we see here in the other side on the St. Lucie. I'm from the Keys. And the flip side is also true. By starving the Everglades of water, Florida Bay, where I'm from, doesn't get it. And we see the flip side of that. So the problems that this system faces are fundamentally a design flaw, or feature, as some people say, of the Central and South Florida Project. So then it's picking which component, which storage, which pieces get you the furthest back. It is not north of the lake. It is, what piece can I drop in that will help us move water south? That's going to solve lots of different problems. The estuary problems, the lake problems, the Everglades problems. And there's one project in particular that you look at and say, that's the storage we need to help us overcome that, and that is storage south of Lake Okeechobee in the AA. It reconnects how it used to work. So I see all kinds of different options and things thrown out there, but they're really just a let's not talk about the thing that gets us the biggest bang for the buck. We don't live in an age of unlimited resources. We have to prioritize and do what makes the most good for the lake, the estuaries, the Everglades, for Florida Bay. And there is one project that stands out, and that is storage in the Everglades agricultural area. Training an engineer. I tell my mom my background is actually in computational fluid dynamics, and she has no idea what that is. But it's basically, what I do is I write computer models and use them to try to figure out how this system works. And it's self-evident, I think, that different projects have different benefits. Now, where I put this, drop it into an existing infrastructure, makes a difference. And I started doing a calculation to say, well, if I had a reservoir in the north, and I had a reservoir in the south, which one gives you the most benefit? And set the models to answer that question. These are models that I was co-developer on, and I've been using them for 25 years. So I think I kind of know. The Water Management District criticized me for not knowing what I was doing, but I'm fairly confident that I have a doctorate in civil engineering from Stanford. I've done this a lot. This is kind of what I do every day.
We love you.
So what I found is that that a reservoir to the south is roughly speaking 10 times better at reducing the estuary discharges than one to the north. And there's a very simple reason for that. If I build one to the north, so long as the reservoir is empty and I can fill it up, it's going to help decrease the flows to the estuaries. But as soon as it's full, I have to stop because the reservoir is full. And the only outlet for that reservoir is Lake Okeechobee. And if I put it back in the lake, guess where it's going to go in the current system? Right past your doorstep here. That's where you have to put it. It's going to continue to rain. There's more hurricanes. So I only have as much capacity as what's in that reservoir to the north. But if I build one to the south, and I can couple it with other water quality features, so I can make the water clean. But the big thing is, there's an outlet for that reservoir that's not like Okeechobee. I send it to the Everglades, and it flows to the Everglades, and it goes out toward Florida Bay. When it does that, I have more room. I can add more water. I can put it in the reservoir, and so I get many times the nominal capacity of the reservoir just by where I put it and how I integrate it into the system. So I did a calculation that shows about a 50% reduction for a 360,000 acre foot, that's 120 billion gallon reservoir in the Everglades agricultural area. Only about a 5 to 6% reduction if I put one to the north. So it's just where you put it matters. And I have many other ancillary benefits from having it in the south. So I think if I can explain that to you and you think that makes sense, see what everybody else says. Does that make sense in a very intuitive way? And if it doesn't, then you can be probably assured that they're not giving you the whole story.
So what keeps the water from flowing south now?
Okay, so we are going to do a little controlled chaos here in terms of the questions. Let me just summarize this and add this one piece, and that is that a bill passed last year called Legacy Florida specified that what the Water Management District needs to focus on are projects that prioritize reducing harmful estuary discharges. That was part of Legacy Florida. Based on what Tom has just said, because the outlet for storage north is the lake and the outlet for storage south is the Everglades and Florida Bay, this is the project south that gets us, that meets that requirement of that bill. Does that make sense? Do you want to add something?
Well, there was a question about what keeps it from going south now.
Okay.
I'll just address that head on because there's some are structural reasons and some are operational. Right now, they go through a prioritization, a priority, where should I put the water? And they tend to want to use the areas that will have the most effect on the lake. Guess which the largest outflow from Lake Okeechobee is? The Caloosahatchee. So they kind of look and say, where can I move this water the fastest? And sorry to say, you guys come to the top of that consideration. The Everglades up until the year before last, didn't really get consideration because it had to go through the EAA, and there was all kinds of, we didn't really want to send water south because it might annoy people further south. But in 2014 and 2015, the water management started sending lots more water south because they could. And the second reason the major infrastructure reason was the water quality capacity. And we've just started getting some more water treatment online, and they could. And that's been very helpful, but it's not enough. We need additional water quality and additional storage. Plus, when the other thing is that the conservation areas, the Everglades, get full occasionally. And then you have to stop putting water in. And as soon as you stop putting water in, because it's full, you have to extend it out the estuaries. But it will go down. It goes down pretty fast. So if I had a reservoir, it allows you to buy some time, and then you can still discharge from the lake into the reservoir. And then when the reservoir is full, put it back when the Everglades drops, because the more water that's in the Everglades, the more flow goes out of the Everglades. It's based upon the water level. So the more water I put in, the more water will flow out. So those are the kind of one, I'm almost sorry to say that, yeah, you guys are the path of least resistance. I didn't want to say it out loud. Thank you, James. But that's what I mean. We have to fundamentally fix the plumbing of the Central and South Florida project. And we do that by adding new projects that say, look, we have to just reprioritize how we're managing the lake, what our options are, what we can do. And those are necessarily big, they're big things. This is one of the largest projects in the world, water management projects in the world. It's no silver bullet, no single project will fix everything. It's part of a long suite of projects. You just have to make those steps that get you the most bang for the buck initially. And then keep filling in the details as you go.
So let's talk for a moment about what storage north of the lake will do, what it can do, and let's touch on water quality before we take questions on this. So the storage north of the lake has some function, some values.
Okay.
And let's talk.
Yes, any project that you build a reservoir for will have water supply benefits. And those are really important. Those are really important. For example, they're building one in the Coosahatchee Basin called the C43 project. It's a big reservoir. And it has a very specific purpose. It's when it's raining, I'm going to capture the water so I can put it back into the river and stabilize the salinity so it doesn't get so salty in the winter. And that's an extremely important benefit. It's not the only problem the river has, but it's a very serious one of trying to moderate salinities, make it an estuary. Well, wherever I put a reservoir, I'm going to get a water supply benefit. So if I build it north of Lake Okeechobee, it's effectively the same thing as adding more water supply to Lake Okeechobee. And that's a good thing. It's during the droughts, I mean, we'll very much appreciate having more water. Wasn't very long ago we were in a drought here and the river needed water. And so having water in the lake is a good thing. It's not going to change those high flows, but it will have other benefits. Another benefit is it does remove some of the phosphorus that's coming into Lake Okeechobee. How much is a little bit of an interesting question, depends on the configuration of the reservoir, but the state has a plan called the Phase 2 Technical Plan, which outlines how they're going to clean the lake. We're not cleaning up what's in there, but how to get to the... Right now we have about 500 tons a year going to the lake, and the limit called the total maximum daily load, it's an annual load, they call it daily load, but it's about 105 tons from the surrounding basin and about 30 tons from the air. So it was a plan, how do I get from 500 down to 105? And part of it was building reservoirs, and they got about 12 tons a year out of the reservoir. So that's good, but it's not a magic bullet to fix the water quality problems at Lake Okeechobee either. And I'm not trying to downplay the problems that we have with water quality in Lake Okeechobee. They're very serious. We need to make progress, but don't get distracted by, you know, ask how much. Ask what it will do, what's the expected change in load, and how much water will we actually get in water supply benefits. So water supply is critical to need to the state. That's one of the major elements of the Comprehensive Everglades Restoration Plan. We need storage, gotta happen. It has a lot of other benefits, but I think the overall best bang for the buck is building a reservoir south and addressing all these problems with one project.
Now take a quick moment and talk about the benefits of being able to, for Water Quality South, and the capacity that we are investing in that exists to the south that we really don't have in the north.
One of the big issues that we have to deal with is if I move water to the south or from the lake to the Everglades, it has to be clean, or I just transfer problem to problem. I don't really fix anything.
And this is kind of the water quality features that the state of Florida has invested nearly $2.5 billion in to clean the water from mostly from the surrounding, the Everglades agricultural area. And a little bit we're finding we may be able to, during the conditions are right, move some water from the lake into the Everglades. There's also one more piece next to that little blue triangle where it says A1. Just to the west of that, to your left, is another 15,000-acre piece that's supposed to be a water quality feature to take water from the lake, treat it, and move it to the Everglades in the Central Everglades plan. But if I'm taking water from the lake and I have to move it to the Everglades and I have to be clean, you kind of look at where the options are to clean it, and that's kind of the only thing you have. You have to clean it before it gets to the Everglades. The Everglades agricultural area is the only place to clean it, and we don't have enough land to do both the storage and treatment on the same parcel of land. We need land to store, we need some land to use for water quality treatment, and it's going to have to be somewhere here because that's the area between the lake and the Everglades.
Great, that's a lot of information. So I want to start asking questions. If you raise your hand, Dawn has the microphone and can locate someone with a hand up, and we'll start to get a few of these clarified.
Hi, thanks very much for putting this on tonight. Senator Negron has just introduced a bill, or been behind the introduction of a bill that aims to put storage south. Could you talk about what the details of that are? Does it both store and treat in the context of what you just recently mentioned?
Actually, I'm not the expert in that, but we have the expert in that sitting right down here, Eric Eichenberg, who's read the bill and worked on the bill and done everything. Can you get him the mic? Can you get Eric the mic to answer that question?
Well, good evening, everyone. It's great to be with you all again. To the question, legislation was filed last Thursday, Senate Bill 10, that calls for 60,000 acres south of Lake Okeechobee to be purchased so that, as Tom is referencing, we can build the reservoir, the above-ground reservoir that's called for in the plan. The plan that's now almost 17 years old. Old enough to have a driver's license, but maybe that's okay. What this bill does is it sets a process where the state of Florida, once the governor signs the legislation, the state of Florida will have until the end of this year to negotiate with willing sellers within this agricultural area, primarily sugar. You have two companies and a handful of other smaller companies that make up the sugar co-op that will be asked to sit down and to negotiate. This is not an attempt to take private property. It's an effort to have a negotiation to buy land from willing sellers. How many of you remember we passed an amendment to the state constitution back in 2014? That is the source of money to make this purchase a reality, Amendment 1. So those dollars, whatever the per acre price will be, and there's appraisals and all that important thing, the stuff that has to take place in a negotiation. If they fail to negotiate in good faith by the end of this year, the legislation then calls for option number 2 to be taken into account. And that option is the state of Florida has a contract as we sit here. And those of you who've been at this event in the past, you all know about the U.S. sugar sale that they tried to work with the state a couple years back. There is one last option remaining that expires in October of 2020, and it's for 153,000 acres that are currently owned and operated by U.S. Sugar. So the legislation says if you can't negotiate with a willing seller, then the Board of Trustees, the Governor and Cabinet, will execute that option for that land, and any land the state does not need, surplus lands, it can sell. So again, there are two options to try to figure out how to resolve the need for land south of Okeechobee. And that's the purpose, and that's the reason why Senate Bill was introduced, Senate Bill 10. We'll talk more about it here toward the end of the year.
What about the treatment part?
Treatment. So this map here is critical. This map, if anything you leave with tonight, in order to solve this problem, or at least to alleviate what we're seeing down the Caloosahatchee, this map is critical. And you see here these triangles, STA, you know, they don't name these things. It's all acronyms and numbers. But STA 1 East on the right, 1 West, STA 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6. Those are all man-made wetlands. Those are some 60,000 acres, soon to be 90,000 acres, that we as taxpayers, the state, have purchased. And these man-made wetlands, the kidneys of the Everglades, worked effectively to remove the phosphorus and the nitrogen from the water, from the lake, and off these sugar farms. So when the water goes through the canals and from that reservoir, it hits all of these different shapes and sizes, these stormwater treatment areas, the kidneys, so that way we can then deliver clean water to the Everglades like Tom talked about. So don't be fooled when someone says you can't deliver polluted water from the Caloosahatchee of the lake to the Everglades or you'll kill it. You'll kill the ecosystem. Well, damn it, we've spent $2.5 billion for land in these stormwater treatment areas to clean up the water. And do not be fooled. We can store it, we can clean it, and we can send it south where it belongs, and we can make sure that the Florida Keys, where people recreate and fish and tourism relies on that economy, just like this economy, we have a proper amount of fresh water flowing south.
Part of the CERP plan, the Comprehensive Everglades Restoration Plan, had a southern reservoir with a treatment capacity and distribution. So to store it, clean it, and move it was all part of the original plan.
Brianna, if I could just add to that. So yes, in 2006, the Army Corps of Engineers completed what's called a Project Implementation Report. This is it right here. It was a critical piece of the Comprehensive Everglades Restoration Plan, always was. This idea that we don't need storage south, is really just made up following the push for the acquisition of lands in the Everglades agricultural area. Those lands you see where you, down here at the bottom, where you see the flow equalization basins to the lower left here, those were the area where we were going to have a reservoir, 360,000 acre foot reservoir. And that was nixed when we moved into the River of Grass project. That was the acquisition of the U.S. sugar lands and assets.
How do we get a copy of that?
You can get it online. You can have my copy if you want. But it details, what's needed, details the reservoir that was proposed. There was a lawsuit that ended up, making this reservoir not actually not happen. There were a number of other situations that occurred. But once we moved into the River of Grass land acquisition, that changed the course of this reservoir. And then once Governor Scott came into office and decided that we didn't want to pursue any lands in the EAA, then this was pretty much shelved at that point. So I think we really have an opportunity with Senator Negron's plan to acquire these 60,000 acres. Maybe less, maybe we don't need 60,000 acres, but this is a real opportunity to accelerate the planning process for the Everglades Agricultural Area Reservoir. Critical piece of the puzzle, needs to happen this year. We need to accelerate it, hopefully start planning in 2018. One of the challenges that we will have if we default to the River of Grass planning process and acquiring the lands that were in the U.S. sugar deal is that we'll have to contend with the leaseback agreement. And that was a 20-year leaseback. I think that was a piece of the plan that we really like. So hopefully they'll be able to negotiate with willing sellers and we'll be able to get that moving along.
Yes.
Hello.
Hi.
One
second. We've got someone right ahead of you.
I believe I know the answer to this question, but for clarification's sake, why is Lake Okeechobee so dirty that it needs to be cleaned before it moves south?
So the reason Lake Okeechobee is so polluted is because of decades and decades of nutrient pollution runoff from north of the lake, from the dairy farms and other agricultural lands north of the lake. There were number of years where they were back pumping large amounts of water from the Everglades agricultural area. That practice has pretty much been eliminated except for flood control back pumping from the communities south of the lake. So there is some back pumping that occurs, but it's primarily for flood control to eliminate any flooding in the communities. But decades and decades of loading, nutrient loading, nitrogen phosphorus loading into the lake and accumulation of muck sediments is really the reason why the lake's so polluted. And even if you stop all of the nutrient loading from the north today, you have 30, 40, 50 years of nutrient loading, internal cycling that you're going to have to contend with. So we're going to need to do some projects to make sure that water is treated properly, it's stored, and to allow those nutrients to be taken up before they're discharged south, because there's a lawsuit that prevents us from sending water that exceeds 10 parts per billion total phosphorus. And to the estuaries, which right now there really are no restrictions other than what we call total maximum daily loads, and that's the total amount of a nutrient that the system can assimilate daily, but it's really calculated in an annual average. So.
And I just add one piece to that, and that is when you take a natural lake and you put a dike around it and you contain it and you don't allow it to do much but go up and down, you don't get that full expression of water change that can come in and flush, and we have limited flushing capacity out of the lake. So we really have a layer on the bottom of the lake that is part of the problem.
Is it my turn?
Sure.
Can you hear me? My question is, we understand that 200 years ago, all the water flowed right into the Everglades. That's pretty simple. We understand that there's so much water every year. Whichever pocket you put it in, it's going to go one way or the other or someplace else. That's not the question that we have at all. The question we have is pollution. Where does the pollution come from? Why can't anybody figure out where the pollution comes from and stop that pollution? We understand that it's against federal laws to pollute public streams and waterways. Why hasn't the feds or somebody got into this and stopped people from polluting? Now you say the pollution has developed over the years. Well, that may be, but has it been stopped? Do we know that it's been stopped? Who's working on that?
So what we have is the Clean Water Act. That's a federal, the federal regulation that governs water quality in the United States. The states are responsible for implementing the Clean Water Act, and we do it through what's called the TMDL, the Total Maximum Daily Load Program. Impaired water bodies that don't meet state criteria are given a TMDL. They're supposed to meet that total maximum daily load, and the process at which they meet that is through what's called a Basin Management Action Plan, a BMAP. And Lake Okeechobee does have a TMDL and a BMAP, a Basin Management Action Plan, but it's a 30-year BMAP. We're looking at 30 years to reduce the nutrient loading into the lake. But dealing with that's just through source control. That's controlling the source of non-point sources of nutrients, whether it's coming from agricultural lands or development south of Orlando. That's just to slow down the source of the nutrients going into the lake. But we have to contend with the nutrients that are already in the lake, the internal cycling that's occurring. So that's going to be through muck removal and other projects, natural assimilation. But I will, warn you that it's taken us decades to damage the system and put it in the state it's in today, and it's going to take us decades, 30, 40 years to restore the system. So, it's not going to happen overnight.
And the short answer to that is that for nearly 70, 80 years, nobody paid any attention. It happened over time. And what that leaves us with today is a huge challenge that is the example of why you don't want to let pollution leave its source and continue to contaminate public waters, because once it's beyond that source, it's a lot harder and a lot more expensive and will take a lot longer to clean up. So we find ourselves where we find ourselves. What we do need, and first I wanted to say also that it is, this Everglades restoration thing is a federal-state partnership. It is the state's responsibility to address water quality. They will point fingers at the feds, but it is not part of the feds' federal government scope of work. It's really the state's responsibility. And they were sued because they weren't doing what they were supposed to do to put a check on those nutrients. So our responsibility, I think, today is to continue to demand that the Water Management District, the Department of Environmental Protection, take a very proactive and aggressive stance at controlling pollution at its source. That has not been the case. In fact, last year we rolled back some protections. So this is something we need to be vigilant about. It's a very good question, but it's one that we have the legacy to deal with.
Thank you very much for presenting this program tonight. It's very badly needed, and I'm afraid it will be needed for many years to come. You're proposing, and I agree with you 100%, to acquire more of the land under in the EAA, as I understand it. I thought, and correct me if I'm wrong, that several years ago, Governor Crist entered into an agreement with U.S. Sugar to do just that. And it was all set, and then the agreement went away. And the state legislature never purchased the land, never put it out. The new governor never followed up on that, and U.S. Sugar decided it wasn't going to sell under the agreement that it had originally entered into. So my question is, why did that happen? And number two, if we're talking now about acquiring what we could have acquired at probably less cost, how much more money will it cost to acquire that which it would have cost than it would have cost under the previous agreement?
Let me address the questions. First of all, there's been a couple major land purchases in the Everglades agricultural area. Back in 1996, Senator Bob Dole led an effort to put money in the Farm Bill to buy land that was here, right there, and that's called the Talisman Tract. And what's happened, the other thing is that they did purchase about 8,000 acres over here from U.S. Sugar, and this parcel over here from U.S. Sugar. That was in 2010. All of this land, all the land we purchased from the Talisman, and the amount we swapped 2-1, quite a state negotiator, we swapped the parcel over here for that. So all the land that's been purchased in the EAA has all gone to water quality features that are focused on cleaning up existing pollution in the Everglades agricultural area. Pretty much that's what it's taken. There are a lot of reasons for that, but the most important thing is that we kind of tended to buy the lands that's further south, and they're also great for water quality features. They make sense because that should be the last stop on the train before the Everglades is to clean it. So that's kind of what the point is if we had 54,000 acres that we bought for storage, and now the state has used them all to clean the water, which is their responsibility. They were pretty much ordered to do it by not one, but two federal judges. That doesn't mean we don't need that storage. Of course we do. We need both. So we can use the features we have, integrate them in, get the most bang for our buck, our best value for cleaning the water, but then we also need the storage. It's essential in the plan to grow the water pie. That's how we're going to be faced, or how we're going to face the future.
You're not answering the question. Question was not answered.
So let me just address the cost. You had a question about the cost. So the average cost per acre under the plan that was negotiated by Governor Crist was $7,400 per acre. It's now estimated that the land within the Everglades agricultural area, because of an improving economy, we're looking at between $10,000 and $15,000 an acre. So the costs have gone up exponentially. In fact, what's really interesting when you start to look and go back to look at this plan, you'll notice that the land cost to build a reservoir south of the lake were a little more than half of what it cost to build storage north of the lake. The land north of the lake was actually more valuable. But now the changes in the economy and you know some of the land that's been acquired south of the lake for agricultural purposes, it's driving the cost of that land up. So by not acting, those land costs are going up, and it's going to cost the taxpayers even more money today than it would have if this would have gone forward under previous circumstances. But unfortunately, we're in a situation now where we're negotiating fair market value with willing sellers, and the market's going to drive the cost of that land.
So let me go back to the U.S. Sugar purchase. So that's what we bought 26,000 acres from U.S. Sugar in 2010. We've essentially used all that on water quality features, so it was used. We had an option to purchase another 45,000 acres in 2015, and the state refused to exercise that option. There's one more piece left, which is to buy the whole thing at fair market value. That expires in 2020, and that's what Eric Eichenberg referred to, that's in Senator Negron's bill, as the last, we still own, the state of Florida owns that option. It's still an option on the table, and Senator Negron has put it back into play.
I want to follow up on that piece. It seems to me that the local communities, the mayor here and the mayors of other cities, have finally gotten together to act in concert to really push this. But at the end of the day, the responsibility sits with the governor. And the governor appoints those various bodies and has been unwilling, apparently, to act. Even though it seems to me, maybe I'm being very naive, that these things are in the best interest of the state of Florida because tourism is the biggest income we have. So I really cannot figure out why he has been unwilling to move forward on this and take the lead.
I'd ask Don if you would give the microphone. I see that Mayor Wang, who has been in the back of the room, who has been the person negotiating with those various city governments and talking with the governor. I'd like to hear his take on this.
Thank you. So the question was, where's the option? The option is still there. It's 153,000 acres. Okay, we took 26,000 acres and we utilized that. The option for 153,000 acres is still there in 2020. Two questions. Do we need 153,000 acres? We're trying to advance right now 60,000 acres. That's what we're trying to advance. We still have that option of 153,000 acres. So let's get 60, because I think all you gentlemen have said 60 may be enough. Maybe. So that's the option first. The 153 goes along with another feature, and I've sat down with representatives from U.S. Sugar, which basically has a leaseback option. So you buy the land, imagine selling your home, and the person gets to stay in the home for 20 years. That's a leaseback provision currently in that option. 20 years to get to use the land. So you're going to have to buy out of that option. So the choice we have in front of us right now is to try to exercise the 60,000 acres. And we're trying to do that, and right now the Senate bill is on the floor. Okay, that'll go the way we think it will. The House will be the issue. And then from there, the pressure comes, and that's why we put together 163 mayors to put the pressure on the House side to go through with that. Because we do have confirmation, part of the integrated delivery schedule, which is what we all play by, the playbook, to move up the land in the design and planning in the EAA. Really what we want is the state sponsor. That's what we need. And honestly, the state sponsor is what the mayors together are trying to have. A state sponsor to put the pressure. Because at the end of the day, we have written authorization, written confirmation from the Army Corps of Engineers to indicate they will advance the planning process in the EAA. Assistant Secretary Dorsey and I sit on the same task force together. She said yes. We need the state component to say yes. So the issue at hand, the gentleman said, is we have two options. The first wants to try to move Joe Negron's plant through Senator Negron. If we can't, the option is still there. It's just that we have no other ability to do anything other than sit across the table from the same seller and negotiate out of the option. And that's really where we are.
And I think that, so in with respect to the governor?
The governor, quite frankly, has consistently said no.
Of course.
You know, you listen to an awful lot of questions why, and you listen to the answers, and you're not anything other than frustrated with the process. So the issue is what it is, but I think honestly what the mayors have done and what we're trying to do is put a whole bunch of mayors together representing the 19 counties that are affected by this. The $2 trillion that are affected from an economic impact. So $1.3 trillion in land value, surrounded by 19 counties and 163 cities. $2 trillion when you get economic impact. So you want to talk about jobs? Talk about jobs all day long, trickle down economy. Jobs from obviously real estate, from tourism. Jobs that obviously trickle down to the retail shops and all the different nonprofits. It goes on and on and on. Those 19 counties, those 163 cities, represent 55% of total real estate in the state of Florida. So that's what we're going to try to do, to try to put the pressure from 163 mayors to say, you know what, here's what we need. And quite frankly, it's an honor to do that. Thanks.
And so to Mayor Ruane and the city council and the cities that have taken that up, because I think it's using that leverage of the elected leaders and municipal leaders to pressure the governor to say, look, you're all about the jobs, let's get to work. This is $2 trillion worth of value to the state. The other side of that is that this is why this bill is so important, Senate Bill 10 has been filed, because we've got to get the legislature. The legislature isn't beholden to the governor. They can make a completely different decision. We need to encourage the Senate to continue to support, and the House really will be our battleground on this, to get them to say, we're going to do this. So maybe you consider that a little bit of an end run. It's a leverage position, but you're right. The governor hasn't been supported.
So I just wanted to bring up, so one of the questions that Rand brought up earlier was the Herbert Hoover Dyke and storing water in the lake. And this is important because during the legislative session, we may see projects pop up that might take some of the momentum away from Senator Negron's plan. And so we need to all be very, very careful and watch all the bills that go through this legislative session. So it wouldn't surprise me if we don't see a bill pop up from the House side that pushes the state of Florida to take over the repairs to Hoover Dyke, suggesting that they can do it faster than the Army Corps of Engineers and use that to divert the funds that would otherwise go to land acquisition south. So those are the types of things that we're going to have to deal with this legislative session. This idea that you can store all the water you need in the lake to protect and reduce the high flow impacts of the estuaries is not true. That's a myth. The Army Corps of Engineers wants to operate the lake between 12.5 and 15.5 feet. When it gets higher than that, they discharge water to the estuaries. It doesn't go to the EAA because they don't want it. It goes to the estuaries. They'll take it during the dry season, and that's why when you look at averages across the year, it looks like they're taking their fair share. But generally, the Coosadgee and the St. Lucie take the lion's share of all of the discharges from Lake Okeechobee during the wet season. So we take the brunt of the impacts, and they take the brunt of the rewards during the dry season. So this idea that we can store more water in the lake and that's going to solve all our issues, that's just not true. Now, granted, one of the key components in the city of Sanibel's Coosadgee Watershed Regional Water Management Issues White Paper is to rehabilitate the Herbert Hoover Dyke. And the primary reason is so that the Army Corps of Engineers has some additional operational flexibility. That gives them another tool in the toolbox so that they don't have to put their foot on the accelerator and discharge water to the estuaries when the lake starts to rise. But the goal of our promotion of that project is not to hold more water in the lake for longer periods of time. It's just to give them a little bit more flexibility, maybe 6 inches of flexibility. That ensures that we have a healthy lake ecosystem and ensures protection of the communities around Lake Okeechobee. and it ensures that we don't have more water in the lake that ultimately is discharged yesterday. So I just wanted to put that out there, you know, keep your eye on this legislative session. There may be some diversion bills out there that may take some momentum away from some of the other bills that that we need to support. So.
And just since you very slickly went to another myth, which is about storing more water in the lake, do you want to talk about the marsh and the importance of the marsh relative to the amount of water stored in the lake?
Certainly, I'd be happy to. So if you look at the map of Lake Okeechobee, you'll notice on the western side of Lake Okeechobee, there's an extensive marsh area. It's identified with this yellow polygon. And the reason why the water quality in the Coosahatchee coming from Lake Okeechobee is significantly better than what comes that's discharged from St. Lucie is because of this marsh system. And when the water level gets too high, generally when we start to see water above 15.5 feet, we start to see impacts to that marsh. It impacts snail crank nesting habitat, wading bird habitat. But you start to see all that emergent vegetation that grows along what we call the littoral zone, that shallow gradual slope from the top of the bank to the water's edge. We start to see all that vegetation deteriorate, and that reduces the ability for Lake Okeechobee to reduce nutrient loads and take some of that internal cycling and remove some of the nutrients that are already in the lake. So that has a major impact on the estuaries. The reason that the St. Lucie saw all the blue-green algae blooms this year, part of it was that they're only about 15 miles away from Lake Okeechobee and we're about 70 miles away. That plays a big role. But the other part is that the water that is discharged to the Coosahatchee is filtered through that littoral zone of the marsh on the western side of the lake. So that is very beneficial, and you know, we need to encourage that, enhance that, not diminish it.
Let's take another question. I threw that out at you, Don. No one's asking questions,
thank you. Okay, a couple questions. With regard to the Central and South Florida project that you spoke about initially, that it was a poor design, am I correct in stating that? I'm not correct.
Well, it depends on what your perspective is.
Well, I was taking it from what you said.
Yeah, the project was designed to take excess lake water and move it out to Coosahatchee and the St. Lucie. That's implicit in how the engineer said, here's what it'll do. I think in retrospect, for example, right if they did that, Commissioner Hurd in Martin County would say that, yeah, she's gone back into the newspaper and found complaints from Martin County going back to the mid-1930s, complaining about the estuary discharges. So it's been a problem. But it was the cheapest, fastest, easiest thing to do. And then what they did is, because they got rid of the excess water at the estuaries and they had no water in the Everglades, they built a series of dams in the Everglades. Because if you have no water, you impound it and you give the illusion of having flow. So that is the basic idea of the Central and South Florida project. It was designed when, in the early 1950s, they estimated the 1970, or the ultimate build-out population of the CNSF project was 2 million people. We now have 8 living here. It's a project from the 50s that doesn't serve modern Florida as well as we'd like. I mean, and so basically what we're saying is, let's invest. We know the importance of water infrastructure, both to do good and to do damage. And I think that's what the Comprehensive Everglades Restoration Plan is designed to do, is fix those parts that don't work for us anymore. And so I would say that the discharging flows from the lake to the estuary is a part that doesn't work for us anymore.
Okay. All right. So I understand that piece. I'm not done yet. Okay. So with regard to this, the 60,000 acres, is that what you're trying to acquire? And hoping that will take place sooner rather than later? The Senate bill that's on the floor, and we have a governor that doesn't support it. hoping that the House will. So if the worst case scenario is we have to wait until 2020 when we have this opportunity to buy this, I mean, what's the impact then if we have to wait that time?
Let's clear that up. So this,
okay, thank you.
Original agreement between U.S. Sugar and the Water Management District had that final option expiring in 2020.
Right.
What this Senate Bill 10 is
proposing.
Right, proposing,
yeah.
Is first of all, we try to find willing sellers. If
right.
we don't find them by the end of this year, 2017, then we exert those options under the agreement we still have, the option agreement we still have.
Okay.
And we look at executing those options. So it's not necessarily extending till 2020.
Oh, it isn't.
Because the bill is actually accelerating that part of the remaining
okay, so
option.
So that could happen sooner than 2020 if this bill is not passed.
Ideally, we find willing sellers.
So,
and
okay.
keep in mind that the Water Management District was negotiating this plan with U.S. Sugar at U.S. Sugar's agreement. So U.S. Sugar was a willing seller 7 years ago.
Let me add one thing. So land acquisition aside, there is a project on the integrated delivery schedule. This is the playbook that the Army Corps of Engineers and the South Florida Water Management District use for planning projects. On that plan, there is a project called the EAA Reservoir Storage Project. That project is supposed to begin the planning process in 2021. And so, because we haven't started the planning process with all of the other projects, north, south, east, and west, that's going to be delayed. You know, that's going to start in 2021. So, you know, we, the City of Sanibel, and our other partners have been pushing the Army Corps of Engineers and the South Florida Management District to accelerate the planning process for that. If Senator Negron's plan moves forward and we acquire the lands, Lieutenant Colonel Reynolds from the Army Corps of Engineers has indicated that will accelerate the planning and construction process. So buying the land in concert with accelerating the planning is really a win-win. So what we need to do, in addition to pushing Senator Negron's plan, which is, you know, to acquire these lands, we also need to make sure that we're, you know, pushing this idea, which is also in Senator Negron's plan, to accelerate the planning process for the EA. Like the mayor said, the Army Corps is willing to do that, but we don't have a state sponsor. So the South Florida Water Management District is really dragging their feet on this. They don't want to accelerate that because they're suggesting that there's other things that have to fall in place for them to be able to move that forward. That's just not correct. They need to do that planning process along with the planning north of the lake, south of the lake, east and west. So that all needs to happen at the same time. So I just want to make sure everybody in the room knows that it's not just acquiring the land, it's also accelerating the planning for that project, which, you know, that's that 360,000 acre foot reservoir that was in the original plan.
So what's the confidence level that this bill will go through, and or that
So actually, I think
I'm sure the people who've been involved with this might have a sense of the pulse of this.
Yeah.
I mean, I know it's politics, I get it.
So I think that all depends on everybody in this room. It depends on you folks, when you go, you know, back to your homes up north, or in other parts of the United States, that you reach out to your senators and congressmen, congresswomen, let them know that the Everglades, it's America's Everglades.
Okay.
It's a critical piece of Florida's economy, and without it, we're not going to have clean drinking water, we're not going to have healthy, clean beaches, we're not going to have healthy fisheries. So it all depends on everybody in this room.
And honestly, what we want to do is the 163 cities, at the right time, to send over a million emails to obviously requesting this. It's really that simple. Why we put the mayors together is to at the appropriate time to make sure when the Senate bill does pass, and they do believe it will pass, the House is going to be the problem. There's your problem. It'll be the House, it'll be the Water Management District. The more people get engaged, we will certainly tell each community, real estate, chambers, tourist development, and every city around, say at the right time, here's what we do. And honestly, you put the pressure on the people.
Okay.
And I'll tell you, until the last day of session and sine die, you do not know what's going to happen. And so you cannot stop writing, calling, you know, give us a chance to have some input from the public. Sally?
I just have one question. The Senate Bill 10 is obviously the vehicle we want to support now. So, okay, where is it in committee now?
It will be going to Senate Environment and Preservation the week. I think it's not published yet, but I think the week of February 7th.
Okay, now
so that will start a three committee tour.
We need to know the names of the folks that we should write directly, handwritten letters saying, get that bill going. We want it. Then we need to know what the comparable bill in the House. Has a bill been introduced in the House?
Not yet. We expect that to be introduced maybe next week. But absolutely, if you sign up for our alert system, that's exactly what we will do, is prompt you at the right time with a message that you can customize, and it will be addressed automatically to the committee members.
I'm doing
that. Here's what's baffling. And there are moments when you have to figure out what in the world is going on here. We spent 242 days last year under a state of emergency due to toxic water from Lake Okeechobee being dumped east and west. 242 days. It was on the national news. The 4th of July was ruined for countless kids and families, let alone folks that came to the state as tourists. This is 2017. I'm tired of hearing about the 1930s and people complaining about the 1930s. What generation is going to stand up and say enough is enough? And sure, we have the brightest minds. We've got three of them right here on this table tonight. We've had enough groupthink over the last number of years to figure out what are the projects and the plan to make this a reality. What we need now is the political will from the people that we send to Tallahassee and to Washington to do what is right. And it's the past legislation that implements these projects. And here's a point. Think about it. There is a viewpoint that you need to finish the projects that are already underway. You hear this all the time. Don't stop until you finish what's currently underway. We'll be here till the cows come home trying to figure out how to do Everglades restoration. And because of that narrow-minded thinking, there's a tremendous amount of Everglades fatigue in this state. People have heard about saving the Everglades since Marjorie Stoneman Douglas is walking around with her pretty hat, telling people to do something about it. This room is packed because we're upset from what we saw last summer along the Caloosahatchee and right out here in Sanibel, Captiva. You want to do something tonight? You want to do something tonight? We're going to do something tonight. Those of you that want to engage right now on the 30th of January, everybody's got a smartphone, right? You've got one in your hand. Everybody's got a smartphone. Take out the smartphone, okay? Everybody text. You text your kids, your grandkids, your friends. Do the text message feature of this. You want to send a message right now to your state senator, your state representative, and the governor of Florida to get this Senate Bill 10 passed and get it moving? Text the word water in your message. Write the word water in your text box, okay? Like you're writing a message to your friend. Text that word water. And then send that word to a five-digit number, 52886. It looks funny. It's not your 10-digit phone number, but that's okay. Send it to 52886, okay? Hit send, and you're going to get a link. You're going to get a link to a widget. Then a widget that you'll open up on your iPhone or your Android or whatever smartphone you're spending money on, and you're going to see where you can put your name, your zip code, and your address, and it's going to pull up your legislator. It's going to pull up who serves you in Tallahassee as well as the governor. And then it's going to be on the right side of that or on the bottom of that page a prepared text to support Senate Bill 10. We sent 7,000 emails the day this bill was introduced to these legislators around Florida because people wanted their voices to be heard. Enough with the meetings. Enough with the packed houses. Enough with the pictures and the dead fish and the lost jobs. Let's do something about it. Take a step today. As this process moves forward, as this bill moves through the Senate and it moves to the House, I'm optimistic of what's going to happen. Because it's going to be less of me and less of Tom and less of James and Rayanne, and it's going to be more of you. More of you. Daniel Andrews is a captain, a fishing boat captain. He runs a group called Captains for Clean Water. I'm sure you've heard of him. When I first met him, I was out on his flatboat off of San Carlos Bay, and he said, "You're standing in my office. You're standing in my office. I'm sure your office is nice over in Miami, but you're in my office. And my office has been closed for 3 weeks due to polluted water from Lake Okeechobee. It's about the jobs in this state. It's about the local economy. It's about the tourism that makes Sanibel and Captiva great. We need to protect it. Text that word water to 52886 and join this movement so that your voices are heard to our legislators that we've sent to Tallahassee."
Protest in Tallahassee, and I will commit that my wife and I will be there, and I bet a lot of other people in the room and from all over Florida will be there, and us sitting on their doorstep will have more meaning. I know that they ignore emails. They and the woman who suggested writing a handwritten letter, as dated as that seems, it has more influence than literally 1,000 emails, because we're all signing petitions every day. We need to go to Tallahassee and stay there until the bill is passed. Not go home, let them do what they want with us. But we need to sit on their doorstep for days or weeks or months until the bill is passed, and go home and celebrate when it's passed.
I'll go with you. We just have a few more minutes, and I do want to make sure we get as many questions as possible to flag April 4th.
Listen, there's a couple dates. April the 11th, there's a group going to Tallahassee if you want to come on the 11th of April. There's a group going on the 4th of April. Keep in touch with Rayanne. There's going to be multiple dates in the month of April as the legislature moves forward so we get a good group of people going to Tallahassee and do what just the gentleman said. Okay. Sir?
Because the Nevron's bill includes the money, or is that a separate amount? Because it could be from a half billion to a billion.
What about but we'll get back to that, sir. The question is, does the bill include the money to make the deal? Is that right? Is that your question? Yes. The bill talks about allowing the state of Florida to bond the Amendment $1, to borrow money. Those of you in finance know that interest rates remain low at the moment. We've got other priorities in this state, too. This is a big one. But the bill allows for the money to be borrowed, and the state would pay back the bonds over a 16 to 20 year period, but it authorizes $800 million for the purchase of these lands south of Lake Okeechobee.
And this would be a federal state partnership, so it would be a shared expense. So there would be a federal piece as well.
Hi, thank you very much for this opportunity. My name is Roger Anderson, and I'm with the National Wildlife Federation. And the thing is that I'm really kind of worried about on this bill is someone tacking an amendment to it. And the thing is that I've testified before the House and Senate many, many times in Washington pertaining to it. And one of the major barriers we had was the Corps of Engineers. They had a great tendency of dragging their feet on clean water issues. Very, very long, very hard to get over. But the main concern would be an amendment that would be tacked on to this bill, which we presented bill after bill after bill pertaining to Clean Water Act. And the thing is that here comes an amendment, and there goes the bill. And the other thing is I've been working with the Great Lakes Basin up, of course, there again, Lake Superior, the freshest body of fresh water in the world, and we're being faced with the problem of E. coli. And I'm just kind of wondering how this water tests out for E. coli. And will that be filtered out? Will that be cleaned out? Because it's a very hard substance to get rid of. And it can do a lot of damage, and...
So Senate Bill 10 is a state bill, not a federal bill. So we have certainly the opportunity for something to be tacked on. That's, again, another call to action. We all have to continue to watch and be vigilant and make sure that, that we communicate with our legislators, the House and the Senate, not take anybody for granted, that we want these issues clean and directed, and it's never that easy. So you're absolutely right. As for E. coli, we do have, you're talking about in the lake or in, we do have, our beaches are sampled by Department of Health for fecal coliform on a weekly basis, so there is that. We have a larger problem with nutrients cycling into toxic algal blooms that are blue-green algae blooms, and so that is that's for us, that's our biggest problem.
And I'd like to address the comments pertaining to being face-to-face means an awful lot more than a letter or an email or what have you. So the people in force are the ones that are going to get action on a bill such as this. And the thing is, yes, it might take some of your time, but the thing is, it's very, very well worth it. There's no doubt about it. And it's a concern that's going to get worse before it gets better.
So I don't want to cut you off, but we're running short on time, and I want to make sure we get as many questions as possible.
Good. Well, I thank you ever so much for the time.
Thank you for
thank
your
you.
Comments.
While we're getting the next question, I do want to say that if you do text that number, you basically go on our list of people that we contact for help. So not only does it send email, but you'll be continually getting information updates and calls to action on what more you can do. So it's a way to sort of join the army working on this bill. We do absolutely need your help. It's critically important you get engaged. The text is just the start.
And I'll add that I can attest to the fact that that list gets people to Tallahassee. I was with Catholics for Clean Water in Tallahassee last Wednesday, and a couple weeks before that, Wednesday before that, being in front of the Senate committee that was discussing these water issues, and that list, they had the room packed with people that were talking about this very issue. So, you know, I think it really helps. It keeps people connected. So, I would definitely sign up and call to action if you can, and go to Tallahassee.
Hi. So I'm from the Tampa Bay area, and we did have a algal bloom kind of mishap, just like you guys did a few months ago. 6 inches of sludge was not great for our economy. We had nothing to flush it out. Do you think that if we were able to restore back to our forest historical flow, because you said that we were almost back to the water that goes into the Lake Okeechobee, how far is that? How many thousands of gallons is that off? And do you think that would help us at all with sludge, maybe nutrient overload?
You're not talking about Tampa Bay?
No, here.
Okay.
Because we had no water. Do you think water down here, more flow, would help?
So let me just, I'll try to answer that really quickly, because the Coosahatchee has a couple issues. It's not just that we get too much water. Generally, we get too much water during the rainy season or during wet times. This year, in particular, for more than 9.5 months, we received flows that exceeded our high flow threshold. And that began at the end of January through October, with a little reprieve in May. But generally, you know, one of our bigger problems is during the dry season, we don't get enough flow. So we don't have enough minimum flow to make sure that the salinity within the estuary is balanced, to make sure that we protect the fish, the seagrasses, the oysters, the things that our fishermen and our economy depend on. So yes, we often receive way too much water when we have these high flow events. We had one in 2005, 2006, another one in 2013, and then of course this year. But in between those years, we don't get enough flow. So it's all about storage. We need storage north, we need storage south, we need storage east, and we need storage in the Western Basin within the Coosahatchee watershed. And that's why we have a project called the C43 Reservoir, which is going to store about a third of the water we need. We need more storage, and we need to hold more of that water in the landscape.
And just to add to that, that's what the Comprehensive Everglades Restoration Plan was targeting, was to figure out how to get the water right.
Thank you.
Thank you. So my name is Daniel Andrews. I just got involved with this fight about a year ago. And actually, next week will mark exactly 1 year. I sense the frustration that's in this crowd. We had our own meeting here with Captain for Clean Water about 10 months ago, same room, and we had the same frustrated voices. What you guys don't see is an incredible, I didn't mean that in a bad way, but we have an incredible opportunity, and you guys don't see what happens behind the scenes. The team that we have, that has been put together, the Everglades Foundation, with James, Brian at SCCF, I can't tell you how many times I put a call through to Eric up there in the front row or to Don at 10 p.m. on a Saturday evening. We're working on this really hard behind the scenes, and we have an incredible opportunity. I mean, this single project with SB10, that could reduce our discharges by up to 50%. That's huge. My office, the grass flats that I depend on to put food on my table are withering away. In the last 20 years, we've had a massive decline of seagrass here. Florida Bay's not getting enough. This is a huge opportunity. I trust this team that we have, the Everglades Foundation, SCCF, TRCP, the Now and Everglades Coalition. We have huge brands behind us. Yeti Coolers, Costa Sunglasses, all of these companies, boat manufacturers, are all coming together. We have an incredible amount of momentum that's built up, and this is what we have now, is a campaign to get this SB10 to the finish line. I've been in communications with the Senate President's office. This is their number one priority. There's nothing else that's more important to Senator Negron and his staff than getting SB10 to the finish line and signed by the governor. They're in an incredible power position to where they can make a big ask of the House. I mean, these elected officials up there, the rest of them, our opposition, they're not just up there to oppose this. They have their own agendas. But I truly believe that with the team we've established, we have the power to get this to the finish line. The gentleman up here in the front that stood up and said, get to Tallahassee, couldn't agree more. We're bringing a big crowd of fishermen and concerned citizens up there on April 11th. I've been up there twice so far this year with James and a couple others. I really encourage you guys, sign up. I'm sure SCCF will have a piece of paper in the back. Write your name and your number down. When they call you and say, we need you, we'll let you know when there's a speed bump in this plan, and we do need you guys up there. It's going to happen. And you guys just need to be ready when the legislators show up to work, and we're all up there with meetings scheduled saying the true story of how this is affecting your life. They can't say no to that. And I want you guys to know, the team, Don, Eric, everybody else that's working on this, I mean, there's dozens and dozens of people. They're awesome, and I trust them with everything. I put everything on the line for it, so we need to push it to the finish line.
BMPs that she's referring to are best management practices. In an urban setting where we live, we're required to have stormwater ponds so that when rain comes and it runs off the land and it washes the roads and the fertilizer off our land, it ends up in a stormwater treatment pond that is treating that water before it goes to some public resource like a river or bay. Agriculture does not have the same requirement. Instead, they have something called best management practices. They are designed as a cafeteria-style plan that you can select to participate in, sign up for, or not. If you sign up, you are given a presumption of compliance with water quality standards. That is part of the problem that we have with Legacy, besides the fact that for many decades no one was doing anything about it. Best management practices today are voluntary. They are not necessarily, if you're generating a lot of nitrogen, you don't have to do a best management practice that deals with nitrogen. You sign up for any best management practice, and then you are self-reporting that you're meeting that requirement, and you are given a presumption of compliance. I can tell you the city of Sanibel, Lee County, no other community gets a chance to have a presumption of compliance just because they say, you know, we're really good people, we're doing good things here. So this is you're hitting on one of the issues about water quality that is very fundamental, and I think it's important to understand that in Florida we have four people. The governor and cabinet is made up of four people: the governor, the attorney general, the financial officer, and the secretary of the Department of Agriculture. That gives an unusual amount of power to that agency, and I would say that we're moving in the right direction, getting more requirements, but we're not there yet. And so that's an area where a lot of work could be done to improve water quality.
And I just wanted to add to that. So it's not the coastal communities attacking the agricultural communities. I want to make that abundantly clear here. I mean, we need agriculture in the state of Florida. It's a critical component of our economy. It's just that we want to hold agriculture to the same standard that the local governments are held to, that they're accountable for the nutrient loads that come off of their landscapes, their, you know, whatever, if it's a municipal landscape or if it's an agricultural landscape, we need to be responsible for those nutrient loads. So it's just critical that everybody is treated the same way. And then we look at regulations. We look at these crippling regulations, environmental regulations that impact the local economies and agricultural interests. But what is the cost of not protecting our water quality? I think that's the real question. And so what we need to get through to the governor's office and get through to the state of Florida is that, what is the cost to tourism? What is the cost to our quality of life? And what is the cost to our property values if we don't protect and keep our water clean? So I think that's really the question. It's not, this question of how we can minimize regulations. It's about what regulations are necessary to protect our livelihoods.
And an even playing field. Dirty water is dirty water no matter where it comes from.
Thank you. I just wanted to give a big thank you to all of you up there and to Eric Eichenberg for being here tonight. You are the good guys. You are the defenders of our estuaries and the Everglades. Thank you. My question has to do with an event that we have coming up on February 15th, where instead of just the good guys like you, we also get to hear from another point of view, Mitch Hutchcraft, who was appointed by the governor to the South Florida Water Management District Board. He's the vice president of King Ranch and Consolidated Citrus. He will be one of a two-member panel speaking at the February 15th League of Women Voters Luncheon here on Sanibel at Sundial Resort. Rayanne will be on that panel. It will be great to hear from her again. But I'd like to ask the three of you, what are the top three questions you think we should ask of Mitch Hutchcraft on February 15th?
Information should be what's driving policy, and for somebody who's in Mr. Hutchcraft's position should be able to clearly articulate the reasons why this is their priority as opposed to doing their reservoir to the south, given all the different information, rather than just repeating it's better, it's good, it's what our decision is. So I think
detailed questions on understanding the factual predicate, the justification for their position, which I have never really heard. I mean, not all we get is it's better, you know, just some continued points. Second thing is that I have been working either in an agency or around agencies now for my entire career, 35 years down here in Florida, and I have not seen an agency behave the way the district does in terms of to me, the quintessential thing was when the district attacked the National Academy of Sciences, which I'm a scientist. They're like, just the most august science body in the world. And so just the transformation of an agency into an attack dog is an astounding transformation for any agency to go through. And so finding out why that is and why there's no dialogue, why the district isn't here talking to everybody in this area, in Martin County, in the Keys. They just seem to govern from the behind the curtain in West Palm Beach. And why the agency is not engaged as much as we are with the people of the state. Those are the three things I've asked.
I've got one question for Mr. Hutchcraft. I think the question is, what would it take to get him to buy into Senator Negron's plan? And why does he oppose it so adamantly? I think that's really the question.
And I think that's a good place for us to wrap up. I appreciate everyone's patience. We will have closing comments here from Eric Eichenberg, and then we will be here. So feel free to come up and ask those questions that we may not have gotten to. I don't want to lose anybody, so I want you to enjoy some refreshments as well. So thank you.
Let's thank Rayanne and Eric for real quick. I spent 15 years in Washington and in Tallahassee and watching politics firsthand. I then went on, I wanted to do something that gave me some good pride in working for an organization and a cause like this is important. But I've watched the horse trading that takes place in the halls of Congress and within the Florida legislature. So here's the point. Don't be disheartened when you read in the Fort Myers News Press or your local newspaper that somehow somebody has done something that's causing momentum to stall or to be temporarily delayed. Just hold on. Hold on. This is a long slog. We got a long way to go. And I will say, there are 160 men and women who make up the Florida legislature, 40 in the Senate, 120 in the House. This decision is going to be made by maybe a dozen people. A dozen people are going to make this decision. But here's how we're going to influence those dozen people. Those folks who reside from Pensacola down over to Jacksonville, down to the Florida Keys, all bring together the rank and file members. What are you hearing back home? What's happening back in your neighborhood? What's the talk at Publix or the Starbucks? That's where you all come in. When you're in the ear of your senator and your legislator, they're out this week. They're all home. So tomorrow, to the gentleman to my right, after you have your morning breakfast, get in the car and take a ride to the local office. I worked in the congressman's office. I worked for the governor of Florida. We love to see constituents. Come in and express yourself. This is your government. This is why we send people to represent us. So take time this week. Again, they're home. Find out where they are. Go see them. Encourage them to support this bill. Yes.
Okay, where's his office?
His office, if Daniel doesn't know, Rand will tell you. Ray Rodriguez, we need an address, a physical address of where you can see him here in this local community. Don't leave until you get the address tonight.
I have it.
Listen, here's the way to find out who your representative is. Easy way, because there's, again, 120 of them. Text that word to order to 52886. You will get your senator and your representative. And you can do it.
His address is 17595 Tamiami Trail South, Suite 218 in Fort Myers.
See the gentleman over here? Didn't hear the address? You can go see Mr. Rodriguez and let him know. But thank you all for coming out here. This is important. You all are committed to spending another couple hours with us tonight. Let's do it, finally. Let's get this legislation passed. And a year from now, instead of the good wine and Coke products over there, let's have some champagne. And let's pop it because we all stood up and did the right thing. Thank you all.
Thank you.